World leaders urging calm following Iran's unprecedented attack on Israel. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres also calling for maximum restraint, with the attack sparking fears of a broader regional conflict. Guterres reminds member states that attacks of reprisals involving use of force are barred under international law.
I stated the following last night, and I quote, "I strongly condemn the serious escalation represented by the large-scale attack launched on Israel by the Islamic Republic of Iran, and we have a shared responsibility to actively engage all parties concerned to prevent further escalation." As the Friendly Relations Declaration of 1970 states, acts of reprisal involving the use of force are barred under international law. We have a shared responsibility to secure an immediate humanitarian ceasefire in Gaza, the immediate and unconditional release of all hostages, and the unimpeded delivery of humanitarian aid.
Israel on high alert after Iran's massive aerial strike on Saturday. Most of the hundreds of drones and missiles launched by Iran were downed before reaching Israel. The overnight barrage was its first ever direct assault on Israeli territory and came in retaliation for a deadly strike on Tehran's consulate in Syrian capital. It remains unclear how Israel would respond to this major escalation in the long-running covert war between regional foes.
Last night was a proof that Iran seeks escalation. Iran launched over 350 threats, ballistic missiles, cruise missiles, rockets, and suicide drones towards Israel, and also other countries in the region could have got that threat on the way. Iran doesn't just pose a threat to Israel, Iran poses a threat to the entire Middle East. Iran, from the beginning of the war, wants only one thing, to escalate the region. Until now, she worked through her proxies, but now she revealed, trying to escalate the region herself.
At the UN Security Council, the United States warned Iran it will be held responsible if it takes further actions against Israel or the U.S., the U.K. representative echoing the U.S. in condemning the attack.
In the coming days, and in consultation with other member states, the United States will explore additional measures to hold Iran accountable here at the United Nations. More immediately, the Security Council must unequivocally condemn Iran's aggressive actions and call for Iran and its partners and proxies to cease their attacks. If Iran or its proxies take actions against the United States or further action against Israel, Iran will be held responsible.
As we have demonstrated, the United Kingdom will continue to stand up for Israel's security and for that of all our regional partners, including Jordan and Iraq. We welcome the actions of our allies to deter the Iranian threat.
Turkish, Jordanian, and Iraqi officials meanwhile say Iran gave wide notice before Saturday's attack, allowing mass casualties and rampant escalation to be averted. The U.S., however, denies receiving an extensive warning, saying Tehran only sent the message after the attacks began. Washington not taking part in a counteroffensive against Iran. Israeli officials say Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's war cabinet is in favor of retaliation, though the panel is divided over the timing and scale of any such response. The White House says the U.S. will continue to help Israel defend itself, but does not want war.
It's going to be up to the Israelis to decide what the next step is here. I will just say this. President Biden, since the beginning of this conflict, has worked very hard to keep this from becoming a broader regional war.
The Philippine government moving to secure the release of four Filipino seafarers aboard a Portuguese cargo ship hijacked by Iranian forces Saturday. Iran's Revolutionary Guards reportedly seized the MSC Aris vessel near the Strait of Hormuz for its alleged links to Israel. The Philippine Migrant Workers Department meanwhile assures the public the four Filipinos are safe and sound and no harassment issues have been reported.
Nandun pa rin on board yung ating mga tripulante, hindi sila bumaba sa barko at sila ay safe and sound sa huling ulat. Pero bagamat ganon, tayo ay humihingi pa rin ng pagkakataon na makausap sila, lalo na yung mga kamag-anak nila. Ito ang isang pagkakaiba nito sa, let's say, sitwasyon ng Somali pirate o kaya mga Houthi rebels. Okay. Iranian government ang nagsagawa ng pagsampa sa barko. Kaya ang meron naman tayong diplomatikong relations with Iran dahil may embahada tayo sa Tehran.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. expressing confidence, the recently concluded trilateral summit between Manila, Washington, and Tokyo will improve the situation in the region. Beijing's maritime aggression was front and center during the historic event, with the three nations expressing solid commitment to ensure freedom of navigation in the West Philippine Sea.
We explored ways of enhancing our cooperation in a number of areas of mutual concern, including in enhancing economic resilience and security, promoting inclusive growth and development, addressing climate change, and maritime cooperation. I emphasize that trilateral cooperation between the U.S., Japan, and the Philippines is a natural progression of the strong relations between close allies.
Aside from defense, the Philippines also bagged investment pledges from the summit. America and Japan committed billions of pesos worth of investments covering the sectors of communication, semiconductor, and nuclear energy. The U.S. International Development Finance Corporation also pouring in $20 million for housing projects in the country.
I'm confident that our collaborative efforts will pave the way for a brighter, more prosperous future for the Indo-Pacific region. Together, we can harness the power of infrastructure and innovation to drive sustainable development and economic growth.
Sydney knife attacker. Six killed after a stabbing incident in a mall in Sydney Saturday. Five of the six victims were women, while eight others, including a nine-month-old baby, were taken to hospital with stab wounds. Police say the assailant, identified as 40-year-old Joel Kauchi, had mental health issues in the past, ruling out terrorist motive in the attack. Australia, a country of about 26 million people, has some of the world's toughest gun and knife laws, and attacks such as the one on Saturday are rare.
The individual stories of those who've been killed, the complete strangers rushing in to help, as well as acts of courage and bravery, mean that whether you know the individuals who've been killed or not, you're grieving today. And the entire state will have to get behind those families in the days ahead as they recover and they go through the inevitable grief associated with such a horrifying, horrifying event. My message is, let's come together. We'll recover. It's going to be a very difficult few days, and those families no doubt have gone through hell, but there's 8 million people in this state that are behind them. Everybody's grieving as a result of this, and they're not alone.
At least 14 people have been killed in landslides on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi. Rescue efforts are still ongoing for those reported missing. Landslides triggered by heavy rains affected two villages in the mountainous region of Tanah Toraja, about 300 kilometers from the provincial capital Makassar. Floods and landslides killed at least 26 people on Indonesia's Sumatra Island last month, with torrential rains destroying hundreds of homes and displacing thousands. And let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. I'm TJ Manotok here at the headlines in the North American region.
Today, we mark a historic moment. We begin with a historic event in Washington, D.C., the first joint summit between the United States, the Philippines, and Japan amid growing tensions with China, following repeated confrontations between Chinese and Philippine vessels in the disputed waterway in the South China Sea.
The United States' defense commitments to Japan and to the Philippines are ironclad. They're ironclad. As I've said before, any attack on Philippine aircraft, vessels, or armed forces in the South China Sea would invoke our mutual defense treaty.
We meet today as friends and partners bound by a shared vision and pursuit of a peaceful, stable, and prosperous Indo-Pacific. It is a partnership born not out of convenience nor of expediency, but as a natural progression of a deepening relation and robust cooperation amongst our three countries.
At the trilateral summit, the United States, Japan, and the Philippines announced new joint naval exercises and new economic cooperation measures. Biden told Marcos Jr. that Manila's partnership with Washington and Tokyo would result in more jobs and more investments for Filipinos. Philippine-American activists and their supporters took to the streets in Washington, D.C. to condemn what they call an increased U.S. militarization in the Philippines. This was part of a national day of action led by Bayan USA in Portland, Seattle, Honolulu, Los Angeles, and San Francisco. Protesters believe this trilateral summit will lead to more war and militarism in the Asia-Pacific region as tensions rise in the South China Sea over disputed territories.
The U.S. government talks about bringing economic growth, prosperity, clean energy, and peace and stability in the Indo-Pacific region, but we know this is a guise for more war and militarism in the Asia-Pacific region, and also an opportunity to perpetuate unequal economic and military agreements. The war and increasing tensions between China and the United States is bringing the Philippines closer and closer to being on the crosshairs of war.
And finally, in 2022, award-winning filmmaker Ramona Diaz documented the Philippine presidential elections and focused on the Filipinos who risked it all in their fight for democracy and hope for a better Philippines. And So It Begins premiered at Sundance in January and will have its Los Angeles premiere in May. And So It Begins continues a story started by Diaz in 2020's Peabody-winning documentary, A Thousand Cuts. The film highlights the hope, heartbreak, bravery, and challenges faced by Filipinos during the 2022 presidential elections between Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and Lenny Robredo.
It was overwhelming to capture it, and we captured a lot. So even the putting it together was also overwhelming. VP Lenny always says she didn't know, they didn't know whether it would be a lonely campaign. They thought it would be a lonely campaign, and then people just started showing up in numbers. And you can see this is the end to something or just the beginning. And that's why we also called it And So It Begins. We wanted to lean in on the hope.
The documentary also features 2021 Nobel Peace Prize awardee Maria Ressa, who has advocated for truth in journalism for years. And So It Begins will be one of the top billed offerings at the 40th VC Film Festival in Los Angeles on May 2nd.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFCNews. Head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manatok, back to your friends at The Rundown.